into the structure of prophecy, looking at how the prophetic word of God has been written in a way that only the Bible can unlock the Bible. We looked into symbols and we realized that symbols are the chastity belt of prophecy, allowing that the interpretations of prophecy remain pure throughout the span of history. We looked at symbols, we then started to go into recapitulation, which, like when you're studying and you recap your work, is just going over the information every time, repeating the same information, but then adding a little bit more. We looked at Daniel 2, and we went through the statue, which we looked at the various elements. We started off with a head of gold. This was in the dream, King Nebuchadnezzar's dream. The head of gold, the chest of silver, the thighs of bronze, and the legs of iron. And each one then was representing a different kingdom which would follow on from the next. The head of gold being Babylon, the chest of silver and the arms being Medo-Persia, the thighs or the hips being Greece, and the king of Greece being King Alexander the Great, and then the legs of iron being the iron monarchy of Rome. And this spanned a period of time from 606 BC into eternity. Let's turn now for a moment to Daniel 7, and we're going to look at verses 2 to verses 14. Interestingly enough here, Daniel has a vision, and he sees four animals. These four animals describe something which is wonderful to look at how prophecy is unlocked through the use of symbolism. Daniel is having a dream, and in Daniel 7 verse 2 he says, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven were stirring up the great sea. And four great beasts came up from the sea, each one different from another." Now we just need to pause here for a moment and have a look at some of the words used and some of the symbols used, because he says, "I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of heaven were stirring up the great sea." Now, we can't go and say, well, those are four winds and that's the Atlantic Ocean. We've got to look and say, Bible, please can you tell us, what are the beasts and what is the sea? What does it mean? This is when we go into Revelation 17, verse 15, and we say, "The waters which you saw are peoples, multitudes, nations, and tongues." So here Revelation 17 unlocks Daniel 7 for us, and we're able to determine from Revelation 17 that what Daniel saw as the great sea is a place of nations, multitudes, peoples, and tongues. And what about these four beasts? Well, Daniel 7 verse 17 says, "Those great beasts which are four kings which arise out of the earth." So it's amazing. I mean, it's wonderful to realize that only the Bible can tell you what the Bible means. Revelation tells us what the sea means, peoples, nations, tongues, and population. And Daniel 7:17 says, "The four beasts which arise there are four kings which arise out of the earth." So a beast is then obviously a representation of a king. Daniel 7 verse 23 says, "The fourth beast will be or shall be a fourth kingdom on earth." So a beast therefore can either represent a king or a kingdom. And that's how the Bible unlocks the Bible. Daniel 7 verse 3, let's continue with his vision. "And four great beasts came up from the sea, each different the one from the other." So Daniel sees, similar to what was seen in Daniel 2, a vision of the statue that had four main sections. Now he gets the vision of four beasts, each one slightly different from the other. Daniel 7 verse 4. "The first was like a lion and had eagle's wings. I watched till its wings were plucked off, and it was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a man's heart was given to it." You'll remember from understanding how we did the symbolism, and we analyzed the symbolism, what wings meant. It meant power, movement, a certain velocity and momentum. And it also had to do with size and distance. So a lion with eagle's wings has to represent a powerful kingdom, the beast, the kingdom, where it has a certain area of coverage or magnitude and power. Well, the lion with eagle's wings is a typology of, or another way of explaining, the head of gold. It's the same time period, and the lion with eagle's wings represents Babylon, the head of gold. The next beast that Daniel sees would obviously, if you're going down the statue, have to represent in the statue it would have been the silver chest, or the chest of silver, with two separate items. And this was Medo-Persia, which was a kingdom that reigned approximately 539 before Christ up to about 331 before Christ. Daniel 7 verse 5 says the following. I saw another beast, he was said, and then in Daniel 7 verse 5 it says, it raised up itself on one side, and it had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it. Here Daniel sees a type of bear with the one side slightly raised up, and he says inside the teeth of it were three ribs. Interesting symbolism. We'll look at the ribs a bit later. But here is a very strong kingdom, very powerful, and it's slightly raised up on one side, just as the arms would have been raised up on the chest of silver. Daniel 7:6, and he says, lo, another. This is another beast, another kingdom, another king. He says, lo, another, this time like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it. Do you remember the analysis we did in the beginning when we looked at Ezekiel and Isaiah and Job? And we said, what do wings mean? And we saw that it had to do with speed and momentum and area coverage to the edge of the word of the earth. The word in Hebrew that they used was kor north. Well, here's a fast kingdom. In other words, it's like a leopard. It's got speed and it's got four wings. Four wings meaning that it would spread at ultimate speed. Well, this represented the same period as the hips of the first statue, Greece, which was the King Alexander the Great. The four kingdoms, which it speaks about in Daniel 8:22, it says, four kingdoms shall stand up out of the nation. Again, this is a perfect recapitulation of what happened with King Alexander the Great, which when he died, four of his generals took over his kingdom. Daniel 8:22 continues. Four kingdoms that will emerge from this nation, but will not have the same power. A beautiful fulfillment of prophecy, because history says that these four generals took over from King Alexander the Great, but they didn't have the same power as what he did in one person. The four generals of Alexander's were Cassander, Lysimachus, Ptolemy, and Seleucus. These were the four generals. And if we look at Theodore Mounsen, who's a historian, he writes in Alexander the Great on page 494, each one whetted the sword against the other, and the empire went down in a tangle of strife. Daniel then has a vision about a new beast, another beast. And if you remember, as we went down the statue, we looked at the legs of Rome, which was a period of 168 BC to 476 after Christ. Now this beast Daniel has certain emotions about. Read it with me. Daniel 7 verse 7. After this I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, a fourth kingdom, a fourth king, dreadful and terrible and strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and brake in pieces and stamped the residue with the feet of it, and it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. Very interesting to see how Daniel has this vision of this powerful beast, this beast that he calls terrible and strong exceedingly. Something that he hasn't seen before is that it's got iron teeth, again representing the similar recapitulation of the iron legs, iron teeth pointing towards Rome and saying that this kingdom would have 10 kings or 10 horns. We'll look at that a bit later. Daniel 7 verse 24 continues. It says, 10 horns out of this kingdom are 10 kings that shall arise. So when I speak about the horns of the kingdom, immediately the Bible will tell us what the Bible means. And Daniel 7 verse 24 says, don't think that the horns are horns. The horns are actually kings. So here's a powerful kingdom that arises and 10 kings that arise out of this powerful kingdom. And each one is represented in this vision as a horn. Again, as the feet split up into the 10 toes, we'd have to look at this in a later lecture. How does this all fit together? But Rome itself, when it was taken over, it was split up into 10 kingdoms. Very, very beautiful symbology, how the recapitulation takes hold and makes absolutely clear what the Lord is trying to tell us. Daniel 7 verse 8 says, I considered the horns, in other words, I considered the kings, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were three of the first horns plucked up by the roots. In this horn were the eyes like of a man, and a mouth speaking great things. I, Daniel, he says in verse 15, was grieved in my spirit, and the visions of my head troubled me. And the same horn made war with the saints and prevailed against them. Verse 21. This little horn that Daniel sees troubles him exceedingly. He says in verse 25, and he, the little king, the little horn, shall speak great words against the Most High, and shall wear out the saints of the Most High, and think to change times and laws, and they shall be given into his hand until a time and times and the dividing of time. In verse 28, Daniel stops and he says, I was deeply troubled by my thoughts, and my face turned pale, but I kept the matter to myself. What Daniel is seeing here is a recapitulation of the information given in the statue he now has in four separate beasts, except that the Lord starts to expand, especially on the fourth beast, the power of Rome, saying not only will there be 10 horns, but there will come up among them another little horn. Let's look at the vision of Daniel 8. Understand for a moment, though, that this little horn is the little horn that we're going to look at in lecture number 5. This is the Antichrist power, something that we're going to have to understand in order not to become part of his deceptions. Turn with me in your Bibles to Daniel number 8, Daniel chapter 8. And Daniel here has another vision. But interestingly enough, this time he only sees three beasts, not four. Now, question. Why would, if the Lord was trying to show recapitulation, why would there only be three beasts and not four? Well, Daniel had this vision at the time where Babylon had already fallen. So at that point in history, there was no reason for the Lord to expound on the idea of there being a fourth kingdom or the first kingdom. The first kingdom at that stage was the kingdom where Daniel was, which was automatically what would have been in the initial statue, the chest with the arms of Medo-Persia. Read with me in Daniel 8, chapter 8, verse 20. It says, the two-horned ram that you saw represents the king of Medo and Persia. The shaggy goat in verse 21, the shaggy goat is the king of Greece, and the large horn between his eyes is the first king. You see here, you have an identifier confirming what you had in the first statue of Greece in the hips and the Medo-Persians in the shoulders and the arms. Daniel 8 reaffirms that, and quite openly he says the two-horned ram that you saw represents the king of Medo-Persia. So this is again a recapitulation of what you saw in the statue and what you saw in the beasts in Daniel 7. Daniel 8:20 says exactly the same thing. Then in Daniel 8:21, it recaps that information and says, but the following king, it says, the shaggy goat this time is the king of Greece. Who was that? Do you remember? This was King Alexander the Great. And a large horn will grow or will be between the eyes of the first king. And here's a clash in Daniel's vision between a shaggy goat and a type of beast with a large horn between his eyes. Daniel 8 verse 20 says the following. The goat knocked him to the ground and trampled on him, and none could rescue the ram from his power. The goat, he says in verse 8, became very great, but at the height of his power, his large horn was broken off, and in its place, four prominent horns grew up towards the four winds of heaven. Interesting that Daniel 8 verse 22 says, the four horns that replaced the one that was broken off represent four kingdoms that will emerge from his nation but will not have the same power. Isn't that beautiful? How the Lord, again realizing what will happen in Greece, that four generals will take over from Alexander the Great, repeats that in Daniel 7 and says, four will take over, but they won't have the same power. And again in Daniel 8 says, four will take over, but they won't have the same power. Daniel 8 verse 9 continues on this train of thought, and he says, out of one of them came another horn, which started small, but grew in power to the south and to the east, and toward the beautiful land. You remember when we were looking into the symbols and we saw wings meaning power and distance and momentum? Well, here Daniel 8 verse 9 says exactly that. I saw another horn, a little horn, in other words, the same as Daniel 7 saw, and this started small, but it grew in power towards the south and towards the east and towards the beautiful land. Wonderful how the Lord recaps it to make sure that we do not misunderstand these prophecies. Let's look how Daniel 2 fits into Daniel 7, which fits into Daniel 8. This graphic explains the head of gold being the same as the lion with the eagle's wings, the chest and arms of silver being the same as the bear, one side lifted up slightly, and the ram with the two horns, again having two separate elements which it relies on. The hips in the statue, referring to Greece, being also represented in Daniel's other vision by the leopard with four wings, and then later on in Daniel 8 by this ram, this powerful ram with the horn between his eyes. The legs of iron being this dragon-type figure, this type of terrible and powerful exceeding, that's the way Daniel tries to explain this vision that he has, also pointing towards 10 other kings out of which would come a little horn, which we'll have to look at later. Time doesn't allow us to go into much more detail than that, but it's quite clear how God uses recapitulation to re-emphasize and to make it clear what he's trying to depict in his version, in his words and in each version or each vision that Daniel has. In Revelations 777, in the next lecture, we'll be showing how the first half of Revelation explains in a similar way the 777 of Revelation, which will be the seven churches, seven seals, and seven trumpets. It's a wonderful way that the Lord uses different methods to describe the same things in an identical writing style, but adding information every time. I get very excited when I get the opportunity to present this portion of the lecture, the chiasm. You see, this is the point where God again puts his foot on the accelerator, and not only does he take prophecy and point out that he's God, but he uses chiastic style writing in the Word to prove that the Bible is divinely inspired. When I was involved in all these occult things and the New Age movement, I had a type of bitter taste in my mouth when I realized that the Christians were so deceived, thinking that the Bible was inspired, meantime it was written by man. They lost in the silly ideology of believing that something which is written by man can be inspired by God. Until I bumped into the chiasm, that is. When I stopped at the chiasm and I realized for a moment that there might be something which I didn't know, as I analyzed and I studied the chiasm, I realized this is God's signature within prophecy. The entire Bible is written in a chiastic style. You could go into tremendous depth analyzing this. But let's just look at an example. Daniel 12. Daniel 12 verses 4 and 9 say the following. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. This is Daniel 12, verses 4 and 9. Again, looking at Revelation, which is almost a stencil by which you can understand Daniel, and Daniel is a stencil by which you can understand Revelation. Revelation says, But he saith unto me, Seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand. So where the Lord tells Daniel to seal it up, in Revelation we are told to uncover. And so the chiastic structure of the Bible starts to come to light. This is probably, and I believe it's the most profound style of writing used in the prophetic books. It comes from the word chiasmus or chiasmus, which is a noun. It's a technique used in writing styles and speeches where things are repeated, but in the middle it's repeated in reverse order. Very interesting. This comes from Oxford Advanced Learner's Dictionary of the 7th edition. It's just a fact of the way certain things were written. Today, if we were to read a book and we were to pick up the book and read the last chapter, we would basically spoil the story because we would know what the crunch line was all about, the punch line, the point of impact. This wasn't the case in those days, though, when they wrote the word. The most important punchline period was in the middle of the book. So if you read the beginning and the end, you still wouldn't have understood the story because the key elements were in the middle. Now, this is God's signature, I believe, within prophecy. It confounds critics and non-believers like myself. At this point, I realized I was out of my depth. There is no way that any human being could have put this together without divine inspiration. The chiasm explains and shows that the Bible itself is beyond any doubt divinely inspired. Let's look at some of the examples. Revelation in itself, just by itself, is written in the chiastic style. Revelation 1 verse 3 says, Blessed is he that readeth and keep those things which are written therein, for the time is at hand. You see, there are two elements to this. Blessed is he that readeth and keepeth those things which are written therein. And the second element is, for the time is at hand. If we go to Revelation 22 verse 7, it says, Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And so Revelation 1 verse 3, the first chapter, third verse, points towards the last chapter, the seventh verse, where the one says, Blessed is he that readeth, for the time is at hand. Here the Lord says, Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keeps the word of this book. One points towards the other. The Bible itself is written in this form. An example of this is Genesis 1 and 2. Genesis 1 and 2 speak about the world, a paradise before sin. This points towards Revelation 21 and 22. The first two chapters of the Bible pointing towards the last two chapters of the Bible. The last two chapters of the Bible tell of the New Jerusalem and paradise restored. If you go back to the beginning of the Bible, we've spoken about chapter 1 and chapter 2. What about chapter 3? Well, chapter 3 tells of Satan bringing sin into this world. And you go back to the third last chapter of the Bible, chapter 20 of Revelation, it speaks about Satan being punished for sin and the abolishment of sin. 1 speaking to 22, 2 speaking to 21, and 3 speaking to chapter 20 of Revelation. And so the Bible starts to work itself towards the middle. This is the area called the Great Controversy. Let's look just inside the book of Revelation, the most profound vision, I believe, of all time, where Apostle John is receiving the revelation of Jesus Christ, revealing what will happen as we move towards the end time. Revelation is split into two parts. It's split firstly into a historical part, speaking about what things are going to take place, and then secondly into an eschatological path. Eschatology having to do with judgment, having to do with identifying what will take place at judgment, before judgment, in judgment. Each one of the historical half and the eschatological half are split into 5 sections. I call them, for argument's sake, A, B, C, D, and E. when you look at the historical half, you've got A, B, C, D, E. And when you look at the eschatological half of Revelation, you've got A, B, C, E, D. Very interesting that those two are swapped around. Everything in the Bible has got a reason for being there. Let's just look at E in the beginning of Revelation versus A at the end of Revelation. What you'll see is that A is a type of interlude. Revelation 1 verses 1 to 8 is an introduction into the Bible or into Revelation, introduction into how to understand. Basically, it's starting one off in the visions of Revelation. At the end of the chapter, at the end of the book, in chapter 22, verses 6 to 21, it's an epilogue. This is a type of conclusion, shutting down the word, the one pointing to the other. Let's show you some examples. Revelation 1, verse 1 speaks about things that must shortly come to pass. Revelation 22, verse 6 speaks about things that must shortly come to pass. 1 saying things must shortly come to pass. 22 verse 6 saying things that must shortly come to pass. Testimony of Jesus Christ in chapter 1 verse 2 is pointing to the testimony of Jesus Christ in chapter 22 verse 16. In chapter 1 verse 3, blessed is he that readeth and keepeth the words. In chapter 22 verse 7, blessed is he that keepeth the words. Here you've got chapter 1 verse 7 of Revelation, behold, he cometh in the clouds. In Revelation 22 verses 12 and 20, behold, I come quickly. In chapter 1 verse 8 he says, behold, I am the Alpha and the Omega. And in 22:13 he says, I am the Alpha and the Omega. Can you see how just in those two chapters alone, one is pointing to the other one, even to the extent of using the same words? Repeating the words, I am the Alpha and the Omega, I am the Alpha and the Omega. Now, we're speaking about A coming towards B, coming towards C, etc., etc. Well, let's go from A outwards, inwards, coming towards the center conflict, which is the great controversy or the conflict of all time. From A, we move inwards towards section B. Section B points in the beginning parts of Revelation towards the seven churches. In the last parts of Revelation, it speaks about the New Jerusalem. Here, in the beginning parts, Christ admonishes his church and there's war, and he speaks about seven cities, right? Here at the end, Christ rewards his church and there's peace in one city. In chapter 2, verse 1, the Lord says, Christ between the seven candlesticks. Here in chapter 21, verse 23, Christ the eternal lamp. In chapter 2, verse 7, the tree of life. 22, verse 2, the tree of life. 3, verse 8, the open door. 21, verse 25, gates are open. 3, verse 21, Christ upon his Father's throne. Chapter 22, verse 1 and 3, the throne of God and the Lamb. Jesus, the New Jerusalem descending from heaven is explained in chapter 3, verse 12. It points to chapter 21, verse 2, the New Jerusalem descends from heaven. Oh, and most importantly of all, I believe, chapter 3, verse 11 speaks about, I come quickly. This is repeated in chapter 22, verse 7 says, I come quickly. A pointing to A, B pointing to B. Let's go over to number C. Number C speaks about the seven seals. This is Christ protecting his children. Towards the end of the Revelation, this is in chapter 19, speaks about Christ crowning his children, the one pointing to the other. Chapter 4, verse 1, speaking about the heavens open. 19:11, the heavens opened. 4, verse 2, verse 4, verse 6, and 5, verse 6, speaks about the thrones, the 24 elders, the four living creatures, and the Lamb. This is repeated in chapter 19 where it speaks about the thrones, the 24 elders, the four living creatures, and the Lamb. Isn't this magnificent? Chapter 6 verses 2 to 8 speaks about a rider on a white horse followed by riders on colored horses. Chapter 19 verses 11 to 16 speaks about a rider on a white horse followed by riders on colored horses. Souls of martyrs under the altar begs for God's judgment in chapter 6. Souls of martyrs resurrected, crowned as judges. This is fulfilled in chapter 20, verses 4 to 6. White clothes are explained in chapter 6 and chapter 7. White clothes are again discovered or explained in chapters 19. Kings, chief captains, the rich will beg to die, according to Revelation 6 verses 15 and 16. And kings, chief captains, the rich are slain in chapters 19 verses 17 to 21. A pointing to A, coming together. B pointing to B, coming together. C pointing to C. But now what about D? This D is over here. We skip one and put D in the middle. See, this is where the Lord starts to put his signature to confound the critics and people like me that say the Bible is not inspired. Section D, which I call it, speaks about the seven trumpets. This is chapter 8 to chapter 11. This is serious judgment. These are warnings to the world. This will be covered all in the next lecture. The section D of the other half of the of Revelation speaks about the seven plagues, serious judgments and punishments to the world, one fulfilling the other. Have a look with me in Revelation 8 verse 7, 8 verse 8 and 9, and 8 verse 10 and 11. You'll see there that Revelation speaks about the earth, the sea, the rivers and the fountains. In Revelation 16 verse 2, 16 verse 3, and 16 verse 4, Revelation speaks about the earth, the sea, and the rivers and the fountains. One pointing towards the other. Sun, moon, and stars covered in Revelation 8 verse 12. Darkness, abyss, also in Revelation 9 verses 1 to 11. This is covered in Revelation 16, 10 and 11, darkness on the throne of the beast. And the river Euphrates mentioned in Revelation 9 is fulfilled in Revelation 16, river Euphrates. Can you see how we're starting to get closer to the middle here? Loud voices in the kingdom of Christ spoken of in Revelation 11 is fulfilled in Revelation 16, verses 17 to 21. Loud voices and thunder saying, "It is done." It swaps over then, and E is now on the inside and on this side. E is basically an explanation of the great controversy. This is where this whole section of the end time starts to make sense. Even though we read the Bible and Revelation included from start to finish, if you don't understand the signature of God within prophecy and the crossover of the chiastic style in writing, it won't make sense. You see, Revelation 11, 19 to 14, 20 speaks about the trials of the righteous and the woman and her children. This is fulfilled in Revelation 17, verses 1 and 9, all the way up to 19, verse 3, where the unrighteous woman's defeat is discussed. Her children keep the commandments of God in Revelation 12, 17. This is fulfilled in the opposite, where her children are prostitutes, in 17 verse 5. Revelation 12, 14 speaks about the woman in the desert. Revelation 17, 3 speaks about the woman in the desert. The beast with seven heads and ten horns is fulfilled. The beast with seven heads and ten horns. One exactly pointing to the other. Babylon has fallen. The Revelation 14 verse 8. Babylon has fallen. Revelation 18 verse 12. Look at how the Lord now starts to piece this together. A pointing to A, B pointing to B, C pointing to C, and then this magnificent crossover of D and E. You see how the Lord has put a crossover signature within Scripture? This chiastic style could in no way have been calculated by man. It makes even more sense now why Revelation has such a stern warning. It says, "If any man add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this book of the prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book." If you were to take one word out of Revelation, the chiasm would no longer make sense. If you were to take a chapter or a verse away, you would destroy the chiasm. This is where the word X marks the spot comes from. This is where hidden treasure is always drawn on a map. X marks the spot. Well, this comes from Revelation, the chiastic style of writing. X marks the point which we have to look into, the great controversy. How do we understand this conflict on earth that has continued as a continuation of the war that was in heaven? This is also the reason why I'm doing these lectures and travel as I do, speaking wherever I get the opportunity to help people understand. Not only is the Bible inspired and written through inspiration by God, but today, as we live our lives in this rushed world, we can still rely on it. Revelation 1 verse 1 says the following. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show unto his servants, even the things which must shortly come to pass. You see, the Lord gives this information to us ahead of time so that we can be sure of where we are in the stream of time. Isaiah 46 verses 9 and 10 is so beautiful. It says, I am God. There is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, from the ancient times, the things that are not yet done. You see, there is none like God. He lives outside the timeline. He's the only being in the universe to be able to look at past, present, and future all at the same time. And then he speaks through his prophets and he says, I will do nothing, Amos 3 verse 7, I will do nothing unless I share it and speak it to my prophets, my servants the prophets. There is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning, all before it happens. We're going to expand on this idea of coming down the chiasm into the great controversy in the next lecture. Revelations 777 in contrast to Revelations 666. Join me as we come down the one side of the chiasm into the great controversy. Thank you.